The top of the worship bulletin is our mission statement. Over here, Alan. Who else on this side doesn't have a worship bulletin? Because you all need one. Yep, Gaston needs one. And Elizabeth, you have one? Calvin. Oh, Tanya, is your hand up?
I got two.
Okay, is that everybody? Everyone has one? Don't want you to miss out now. Okay, please open your worship bulletin to the inside. And on the top left corner, it has something. Please, everybody, read that out loud together. Ready? Together, all together. Welcome to Crestline First Baptist Church, where we are in God, encouraging one another, growing as Christ's disciples, and sharing Jesus. That's the mission statement of this church that we are committing to again today. It's an annual commitment, an annual covenant that we make. Covenant being a more important relationship, a spiritual relationship. And we are renewing that covenant, and we do that on an annual basis where we say, okay, we believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for us. We've identified with him publicly through baptism, and now we want to join with these other people to serve Jesus together, to love him more, God and one another, to encourage one another in our relationship with him, and to come alongside of each other in tough times as well as joyful times, to grow as Christ's disciples, to really be truly become more like Jesus in every aspect of our lives and help others to become more like him also. And then finally, to share Jesus. God has said that we are supposed to go back out into the world and shine our light, be salt of the earth, let people see who Jesus is through us. So today, I thought in order to try to help us understand the covenant, it might be helpful to look at a book in the New Testament that really speaks a lot about covenant. It speaks a lot about sacrifice and the sacrificial system. It talks about the high priest and the high priest's responsibility. It talks about the tabernacle and the role of the tabernacle in the Old Testament. You have to remember that everything that we believe has been built upon what God did with his people, Israel, his chosen people. Genesis 12 really describes the original covenant when he says, I will bless you so that you will become a blessing, Abraham, so all the nations of the world will be blessed through you. That covenant gets renewed then several times throughout the Old Testament. Moses especially will come and take that covenant now and take it to a higher level as God gives him the Ten Commandments, as we refer to them, the instructions for how to live. And again, the people are prepared. In fact, if you remember something about that, you'll remember that the day that Moses brings down the Ten Commandments and commemorates them and has the people commit to them, do you remember what he sprinkled on them? Blood. Blood. On the word that he had gotten from God, and he sprinkles blood out on the people. Blood is important to the forming of a covenant. Blood has to be taken in order for a covenant to be formed. So today we're going to look at Hebrews 9, verses 11 to 15. But when Christ came as high priest of the good things that are now already here, he went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not made with human hands, that is to say, is not a part of this creation. He did not enter by means of the blood of goats and calves, but he entered the most holy place once for all by his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption. The blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean sanctify them so that they are outwardly clean. How much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death so that we may serve the living God? For this reason, Christ is the mediator of a new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, now that he has died as a ransom to set them free from the sins committed under the first covenant. What we're looking at today is that with the sacrifice of his blood, Jesus initiates a new covenant. It's his blood. And then we're going to look closely at this text. It's his blood that cleanses our consciences and frees us from guilt and sets us free from sin. And today we want to renew our commitment to him. Hebrews says that he is a living tabernacle. John 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. Now he was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Hebrews says Christ was the brand new tabernacle, a different tabernacle. Just a quick reminder, what was the tabernacle in the Old Testament? The tabernacle was a tent that was established for Moses and the children of Israel where they could meet with God, where God could bring messages to the people. It was a place where sacrifices took place. There was even the Holy of Holy Places in there. There was a place of meeting and gathering. And people would meet at the outside. It was a reminder. In fact, God's Shekinah, his glory, shone over the tabernacle. It was a reminder to the children of Israel that wherever they went, God was with them. John MacArthur, talking about this text, says the first covenant wasn't satisfactory. It could not set things straight. Its sanctuary was meaningful, its services were meaningful, but the significance was as a picture of Christ and a lesson in itself of inadequacy. And if you don't have Jesus Christ, all you have is an inadequate system into which the Spirit of God has built the inadequacy so that you can see it right there. So the old, sure, divine services, a divinely ordained sanctuary, but earthly, passing, and temporary. And what MacArthur's trying to say is that the old tabernacle, which was great, it was great for a meeting place, it was great to remind people that God was with them, but it was a temporary tabernacle. Hebrews says that Jesus is now a much better tabernacle, a new tabernacle, a permanent tabernacle. He was there since the beginning of time, as John's trying to describe for us. So Jesus is much more so as a tabernacle. What's a tabernacle? A tabernacle is where God dwells or stays, is present in them. God dwells, is present within Jesus Christ. God in the flesh. The old sacrifices, you'll remember, were not able to wipe away sin. Did you understand that? In the Old Testament, sacrifices didn't totally remove sin. The word that's used there is a word we find in the New Testament called propitiation. It's a covering over of sin. And so every year you would come to Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, and what would they do? The high priest would go in and he would offer sacrifice. Initially, I've got to be careful here, I'm going to get ahead of myself. Initially, he would offer sacrifices and put blood inside the temple, inside the Holy of Holy Places for himself. And while he was going in there, guess what the people were doing? They're outside praying that he comes back out. Okay? He had a rope tied around his ankle so that if he had sinned and the sacrifice didn't cover his sin, he would die in there because of his own holiness. But if God accepted the sacrifice and the covering for his sin, then he would come back out. So they're literally outside praying. We pray that the priest comes back out. Because if he comes back out, then he's going to go back in a second time. When he goes back in the second time, he's going back to offer sacrifices on behalf of the people, our sins. How many sins do you think you could commit in a year? Well, you should keep track, right? In fact, if you're celebrating Yom Kippur, you better be keeping track, because you got to make sure that they all get covered over at the end of the year. Somebody's keeping track, aren't they? Of what sins we're committing. So once a year, the high priest goes in there, and for that time, and notice this, this was a past tense. The priest was covering the sins for the whole entire year. So that then you could go back out the following week, start sinning new again, right? Because you've had your sins covered for a time. But Jesus offers a brand new perfect sacrifice. Jesus uses his own blood, notice this, his own blood to go into the Holy of Holy places. He uses perfect blood. Leviticus 17:11 said, "The life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it for you upon the altar to make atonement for your souls, for it is the blood that makes atonement." Was that a Hebrew principle? Without the shedding of blood, there can be no atonement for sin. In order for sin to be taken away, there has to be the shedding of blood. Matthew, we read this earlier, "Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins.'" I appreciate what Westcott says, and he talks about this blood covenant and this sacrifice that Jesus made. Number one, he says that the sacrifice of Jesus was voluntary. The animal did not volunteer, by the way. The animal simply was killed. But Jesus volunteers to have his blood taken and shed for our behalf. The sacrifice of Jesus was spontaneous. Not for the animal. They had to find the unblemished animals. They chose them. There was very selective, very legal process that you had to go through to make sure that you had the right animals to cover over the sin and the guilt of the people. Jesus' sacrifice was rational. The animal didn't know what was happening to them. It was done to them. The animal's life was taken. Jesus dies not as an ignorant victim, caught up in circumstances which he can't control like the animal, but he chooses wide open to sacrifice himself for our behalf. And the sacrifice of Jesus was moral. If the animal sacrifice was just mechanical, I mean, you learned how to, you take the knife, you learn how to slit the throat, you learn how to put it in and cut the stomach and let all the parts be destroyed. You knew how to take parts away. It was a very mechanical, not moral, amoral process. But what happened on Calvary was not mechanical at all. Jesus was obeying his Father and sacrificing his life so that we could be forgiven. See, the fact is, we cannot be forgiven without sacrifice. In the rest of Hebrews chapter 9, it's kind of an interesting passage, because the word that we've been using for covenant suddenly gets translated testament or will. What has to happen for a will to be finally executed? Somebody has to die. The person that the will is on, it's on their behalf, has to die in order for the will to be executed. Now, I know the prodigal son came and asked for his inheritance ahead of time. But the will wasn't executed. Dad decides to give the wealth to the son. But for a will to be executed, somebody has to die. In fact, today in California, if you're going to execute a will, you've got to give an actual signed official document showing a death certificate that proves that you died, that somebody's not just taking your wealth from you. So therefore, a will or a testament demands death, doesn't it? Someone has to die. Forgiveness demands blood. Blood has to be shed. God set this up, that the only way that sin could be taken care of was through the shedding of blood. and on our behalf, judgment. Judgment requires a substitute because we can't handle the judgment. And so Jesus takes that place for us. Christ sets us free, Hebrews says. And I love some of the things that come out of here in chapter 9. It says, he sets us free from our consciences. He actually clears our consciences. Now, some of you felt a little bit of a guilt or shame this morning earlier when I said, have we betrayed him? Did anyone feel that? How many of you talked to, when I asked you, have you sinned this year? Any tinge of guilt? Just a little bit, I hope, okay? That guilty conscience is not a bad thing. Actually, it may be a friend of ours. Sometimes it's a guilty conscience that will keep us from doing more sin. It keeps us from making bad choices. It says, well, we are set free, Jesus said, from guilty conscience. I like the way Barclay put it. It says, the sacrifice of Jesus gains forgiveness for past sins. We ought to be punished for what we've done and shut out from God. But because of what Jesus did, the debt is wiped out, the breach is forgiven, and the barrier is taken away. Thank you, Jesus. Secondly, Barclay says, the sacrifice of Jesus opens a new life for the future. It opens the way to fellowship with God. The God whom our sins had made a stranger, the sacrifice of Christ has made into a friend. Because of what he did, the burden of the past is rolled away and life becomes life with God. Hebrews 12 says it this way. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Jesus sets us free from sin. Jesus sets us free from the guilty conscience that we have. That's a normal thing unless we've killed it off. And isn't that one of the dangerous things that we face? The more often I commit a sin, the more I'm going to kill off my guilty conscience and no longer feel bad about what I do. And you put that in any such situation. So the guy that starts looking at porn, starts looking more and more at porn, and pretty soon he's kind of, you know, lost that sense of, you know, okay, I shouldn't be doing this. Or the guy that's driving too fast down the road, you know, it's okay as long as they don't catch me, right? Or you put whatever sin you want in there in place of the two I've just mentioned. The more we commit something, I mean, are you aware that people who commit adultery actually start to talk themselves into saying this is okay? Do you know that I've actually had people come and say, would you please pray that I can marry this other person and get out of my marriage? What? You realize what you're asking me? I mean, and folks, I'm not joking about this. There is a sense in which as we fall into sin, we start walking away from God and we start saying sin's okay. And you can just watch some local newscasts to find out how we do that all the time. But Christ wants to set us free, both from the guilt of sin, but look at this. He also wants to set us free to serve. He wants to free us up so that we're not ashamed, we're not guilty, and we're able to freely serve other people. I want you to think about some of the opportunities you have to serve right here in this ministry. Our life groups are a great opportunity for service, probably one of our best opportunities for service. It's where pastoral care takes place. I know you hired a pastor and you expect me to do pastoral care for all of you, right? But most of you don't give me the time or the space to actually do that. That the real pastoral care takes place in relationships with one another. As we come alongside each other, as we listen to each other, as we cry with each other, as we rejoice with each other, as we pray for one another. That's where the real pastoral care takes place. That's where we help one another to grow closer to Jesus, to become more strong, more like Jesus, growing as his disciples. That's even one of the best ways for us to share Jesus with our community, is to invite people out there in our oikos who don't know Jesus to get to know the people in our life groups, in our small groups. Life groups are a great opportunity for you to serve. Here's one, Mountain Help. Yeah, we went through a name change because we have a church that's here in the community now called Mountain Hope. So we're now Mountain Help. What's Mountain Help? Mountain Help is, for those of you who actually buy script cards, you're actually helping to fund Mountain Help. Mountain Help is our resource for ministering to the needs of people in this community. And we give things like diapers, and we give, well, here's a fun one. We give dog food and cat food. And you, well, that's not a very helpful thing, is it? Diapers, dog food, and cat food. Pastor Bill, shouldn't we be giving them food? Well, you see, there's a lot of agencies and organizations on the mountain that give out food. And most people that get some kind of resources, and we also give information for all the different kinds of resources that are available up here, but most people that get resources may get something from the state, from the government, a food card, but it's limited as to what they can purchase with that. Well, one of the things that they can't purchase is diapers, toilet paper, dog food, cat food, hygiene items, okay? Some very natural, necessary items. And so we provide them. Well, in Mountain Help, we need some people who would be willing to say, you know, the phone rings, and we actually have a line for Mountain Help. I'd be willing to call people back who call up asking for help. By the way, we'll train you, but consider that. Maybe God wants you to serve as a on-call helper. Here's an interesting one. Judy's trying to create some new curriculum for how do we minister the needs of people in this community in a healthy way. What are some creative things we might be able to do? For instance, maybe come alongside and help somebody learn to read, or help them with computer skills, or doing a resume, or something like that. And there's all kinds of resources out there, but we want to try to help point people away and create some curriculum that would really minister to people's needs. Maybe you want to help create that curriculum. So Mountain Help, and by the way, buy the script cards. It's the easiest way to help. You literally have to do nothing. I don't think I've sold you on that idea yet. So please, do me this favor. Those of you who buy food, who buy something, either from Goodwin's or Stater Brothers, raise your hands. Higher. Whoa, it's a ton of you. So you all spend money at one of those two stores, right? Did you know that if you will simply buy our script cards, dollar for dollar, that 5 or 6% of every single dollar that you spend there will come back to help Mountain Help? And it's costing you nothing because you're going to spend the money there anyways. I'm sorry, it does cost you something. It costs you remembering to buy the cards, doesn't it? It costs you some discipline, some exercise. And who should we talk to if we want to buy script cards? Wave, Amy. Here's some other opportunities for service. How many of you like it when people are friendly to you when you come here on Sunday morning? Oh, look at that. Some of you like it. The rest of you would rather we weren't friendly, right? If you like it, you know, here's one thing. We need people who will be right there at that front door and greet people and be friendly. Here's one of the places where we need some people. How many of you have found it sometimes challenging to find a parking place? Nobody? Stanford. Some over there? Okay. Finding a parking place, especially if you come a little closer to the beginning of the time. Guess when guests normally come? They usually get here an hour early, right, to see what it's really like. No, guests are probably going to drive up here right about 10:15, or maybe even 10:20, because they don't want to have anybody bug them when they come in. Guess when we need to have parking places for them? You can help serve by where you park. Not only that, it'd be really nice to have somebody outside there that's, you know, greeting people. Maybe when it's raining, I know it doesn't happen a lot, but it has this year, that you're out there with an umbrella and, you know, let me help you get out of your car and get in here. There's things that we need to do in the greeting and welcoming that's about serving people. We need intercessors who are willing to pray for other people. We actually have a prayer team that's willing to pray for people on an emergency basis. Maybe God wants you to be one of those prayer warriors. How about this, helping with children and youth? Debbie's actually in worship today, but you know, there's some truth to the fact of if you build it, they will come. If you don't have a good nursery, they're not going to come. If you don't have good children's ministry, families are not going to be here. So think about that. Maybe God wants you to be a part of that. Are you technologically gifted? Let's see. That was probably an age discrimination question, wasn't it? But have you worked with sound or audio? We need people that can help serve there. Maybe you're musically inclined. You're a vocalist. You can sing. We need people who can join in being part. Have you seen how we've been kind of shifting and changing up here? Did you hear the drums this morning? Especially on that one song where he kind of like went, da-da-da-da-bam, and really kind of drew you, didn't you? It was cool. We need people to be part of that. And probably our most important service, we need people who are willing to share Jesus in that community, out there, with the people that you know. Jesus came as our high priest, paid the price with his blood, covers our guilt, removes it, and frees us from sin so that we now can go serve. And folks, if all you're doing is sitting, you're missing out on what Jesus wants to do through you. Christ comes to mediate a new covenant. But I got to ask you this. How glibly do you confess your sin? Okay, Jesus, forgive me my sin. I did it again. How glibly do you go to Jesus? Forgiveness is not cheap. In fact, forgiveness is not free. Forgiveness cost the blood and life of the perfect Lamb of God, Jesus Christ. That wasn't cheap, and that wasn't free. Barclay, in speaking of this, says forgiveness is never a case of saying, it's all right, it doesn't matter. It is the most costly thing in the world. Without the shedding of heart's blood, there can be no forgiveness of sin. Nothing brings a man to his senses with such arresting violence as to see the effect of his sin on someone who loves him in this world or on the God who loves him forever, and to say to himself, it costs that to forgive my sin. Where there is forgiveness, someone must be crucified. The last thing that Hebrews says that we get as a benefit from this new covenant that Jesus is mediating for us is an eternal inheritance. 1 Peter says it this way, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you. By the death of Jesus Christ and our belief in him, we've got an inheritance. And it's being stored up for us in heaven. And it is a good thing. It's not just flying around on clouds. I'm sorry. Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, is when the high priest made sacrifices for the sins of the people that were committed during the past year. Jesus comes and he pays the sacrifice for the sins of all people who want to accept that payment. In Hebrews 10, text not long after our text for this morning's message, verse 19, therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place, once a year the high priest got to go in there. Once Jesus entered the holy place, which is the throne in heaven, once Jesus goes in there, we can go in at any time. we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain that is his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, there it is again, and having our bodies washed with pure water. And let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another and all the more as we see the day coming. Are you willing to covenant again today with us? Jesus said we're supposed to go. He says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. Surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. You, in order to covenant and in membership with us, you have to have made that commitment to Jesus Christ. You have to have become one of his disciples. Now, anybody's welcome here all the time, right? To participate in everything. But to make this commitment of this covenant to one another takes that personal relationship first off with him. We covenant to him. And in that covenant to him, we then get baptized, identifying our lives with Jesus Christ, making that public declaration that Jesus Christ died for us and rose from the dead, and we're now sharing in that death and that resurrection. And then we go out and we make other disciples. Jesus said, he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. And we have a responsibility to go out there into all the world. In making our commitment, our covenant to one another, we're saying we're going to go into this world. We're going to go out there together. Peter said it this way in Acts 2, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. There is a place in which we all have to come to a place of brokenness. We say, God, I'm sorry. I need to change. I'm going to turn from whatever I've been doing. And frankly, don't we all have to do that every day? There's a sense in which every day we need to repent and be baptized. Yes, there's that one time where we publicly declare our choosing, we're following Jesus. But there's an identification that we need to do with Christ every day, in which we continue to tell this world around us that Jesus matters to us. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. You will receive the power you need to serve in this community. And God's looking forward to giving you that power. Would you open up your worship bulletins again, please? Inside your worship bulletin is our actual membership covenant. You also, I believe, have a card. Y'all have a white card. Y'all see that? That's your membership covenant for you to take with you. Do you also see the yellow card? The yellow card is your oikos list. The people that you know who don't know Jesus. And there's people in your oikos that do know Jesus. Who are the 8 to 15 people that you spend time with every week? Or on a fairly regular basis, maybe it's every couple weeks. Who are those people that you spend time with? You want to start identifying them, put those names on there, and start praying for them. And then if they're all Christians, they're all super saints, you need to start praying that you get some other people on your list that don't know Jesus. Who's in your oikos? You're going to find that some of them know Jesus and some of them don't. And God wants you praying for them all. Our covenant, and now you can either take it from the inside of the bulletin or on the card. I have accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior. And having been baptized as a believer, now feel led by the Holy Spirit to commit to membership with Crestline First Baptist Church. I really believe that that's a spiritual decision. Holy Spirit moves us. The Holy Spirit brings us here. The Holy Spirit sets up divine appointments for us to build relationship with Him, to serve in this community. Spirit of God's at work in us, and we follow, we obey what he asks us to do. And when we make this covenant to one another, here's what we're committing. I will protect the unity of my church by acting in love toward other members, by refusing to gossip, by following the leaders. Jesus prayed on the night before he was sacrificed. He prayed that we would be one with him and the Father like he and the Father are one. He prayed for a unity. Unity mattered so much to Jesus that it was a burden on his heart as he's getting ready to die. If it mattered that much to him, it ought to matter to us. And one of the biggest dangers in any group of people is that we talk about each other rather than talking to one another. Our membership covenant says that we want to care for one another. We are committed to one another, and we're not going to do the things to try to undermine each other. Secondly, I will participate in the mission of my church by living a godly life, by inviting the unchurched to attend, by warmly welcoming those who visit. And by the way, when we say to invite people to attend, I got to tell you, you got to start by inviting people into your life. You got to get to know them. You know, there's the occasional person who might be one to Jesus Christ because a stranger just walks up to them and says, "Have you invited Jesus Christ into your life? Would you like to?" And somebody says, "I've never thought about doing that. Thank you so much. Yes, I would." So just say yes.
Yes.
See there? See how easy it is? That's almost never the way it happens. Okay? Unless the Holy Spirit has sent you to that person, it just doesn't happen that way. You got to invite them into your life. You got to get to know them. You got to spend time with them. You got to really care about them. You got to care so much that your heart's burdened because you're afraid that they're going to go to hell without Jesus Christ. That you love them so much that you're going to give yourself to them. In fact, you'll love them so much that if they say, "I don't want anything to do with Jesus," you still care about them. Because your goal is not a mark on your cross, somehow a flag you put on your Bible that says, "I witnessed to another one, but they didn't give in." No, your goal is just to love people. You got to invite people into your life. Our membership covenant says, we're not just going to try to invite people to this building, because frankly, this is not the church. The church is people. So we're going to invite them to people. Into our home, into my life, and to the people I know, as I get to know them and the people they know. I'm just going to care about them. A membership covenant also is one that says, I will help with the ministry of my church. And what did Hebrews say? Jesus sacrifices himself, sets us free from guilt and the conscience so that we can serve. We're able to serve because Jesus has died for us. So I will help by discovering my gifts and talents, by being equipped to serve, and by developing a servant's heart. And isn't that probably the most important one on there? Again, it's not, okay, we need a whole bunch of people that are going to scrub the floors here. Yeah, I know there's some dirt on the floor over there and probably needs cleaned up this morning, but, you know, well, we need people to, you know, that are going to work on the outside of the building. And yeah, there's things that need it. There's leaks and stuff like that, and plastering needs to be done, and painting needs to be done. But again, that's not the most important thing, is it? Well, we need people to, you know, work on the parking lot out there, you know. Or the fact is, while there's stuff that needs to be done here, and some of you may have that kind of ability, what God really wants us to do is to be serving out there. Now, please, you know, those of you who are taking time to like work every week on worship team or help with children or things like that, I'm not trying to downplay the significance of that. I'm just saying that all of us are called to serve. And when we sign this membership covenant, we are saying we are going to commit ourselves to allowing Jesus to serve through us. And we're going to give ourselves to serving him and this community. And then the fourth one is, I will share the responsibility for my church. In our covenant, we're saying, look, we are going to pray for its growth. And really, are we praying that this church grows? Is that really? You know, I think this covenant needs some fixing. We're really not praying that this church grows. Unless that growth means we grow in our love for this community. And we grow in our love for Jesus Christ. You see, it's not praying that we grow numerically and we get a whole bunch more people here and, you know, that gives us more money and we build a bigger building and get more people. And No. Praying that we grow in our love for this community and in our love for Jesus Christ. And then we'll participate and we'll give. And giving is so much more than money, isn't it? Obviously, that's a part of it, because that kind of says what's important to you. You know, go back and how many of you are going to get to do taxes and just or have already gotten to do them? Anyone? Jesus said, "Render unto Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and unto God what belongs to God." We have a responsibility, and as you do your taxes, it might be a good time for you just to look and say, "How did I spend my money this year? How much of it did I spend on me?" Parents, how much of it did you spend on the kids? No. How much of it did you spend on you? And how much of what you have did you spend for God? What I'd like to invite you to do today, if God is leading you to covenant, to be a part of this ministry,